Underwriting for Heroes and Patriots is provided by Dr. Richard Phillips at the Ukiah Dental Center, located at 307 Luce Avenue, Ukiah. Visit his website at ukiahdental.com. Dunlap Roofing, roofing and gutter services, with offices in Fort Bragg, Ukiah, and Willits. Visit their website at dunlaproofing.com. Fry Vineyards and Winery, located in Redwood Valley, America's first organic winery, great local wines with no added sulfites, produced biodynamically, on the web at frywine.com. Underwriting is also provided by Orr Hot Springs, a retreat and natural hot springs located between Mendocino and Ukiah. Reservations are required. Please call 707-462-6277 or visit their website at orrhotsprings.org. Heroes and Patriots is hosted by John Goodiron and Mary Massey. The show is about national security, intelligence, and foreign policy. And today we will be speaking specifically about national security with our guest, Chip Gibbons. Chip, are you with us?
I am.
It's great.
Pleasure to be on your show.
Welcome. Well, let me tell folks a little bit about you. Chip is a writer whose work has focused on civil liberties, U.S. foreign policy, social movements, and the Middle East. His work has been published in the past by Truthout, Dissent News Wire, and Counterpunch, among other publications. He has maintained the blog Exiting Emerald intermittently since 2011. Chris Gibbons has been active on defending the civil liberties of Palestinian human rights activists. In 2014, he testified before the Maryland General Assembly on a bill aimed at punishing academic associations supportive of Palestinian human rights. He gave presentations about the attempts to censor supporters of Palestinian human rights at the 2014 Mid-Atlantic National Lawyers Guild Conference and Left Forum 2014. Mr. Gibbons attended Bard College, where he majored in history and political studies. He later received a Juris Doctorate at American University Washington College of Law, where he was also co-director at the National Lawyers Guild chapter. He completed an undergraduate thesis on the Central American Peace and Solidarity Movement. Chip has studied both as an undergraduate and as a law student, studying the effects of anti-terrorism legislation on the First Amendment rights of solidarity activists. Chip, I'm going to bring our John in. John has been back from 3 weeks in the Middle East and India and has been spending some time in his second home in New York. So we welcome John back to the show.
Thank you, Mary. I've heard nothing but good things about the job you've done in my absence from listeners, underwriters, members, et cetera. Good job. Just a little bio on Mary. Mary is a former national radio personality at Nashville Public Radio. So we're very lucky to have her here at KMEC Radio. So it's good to be back, and let's fire away on the issue of domestic terrorism in Charlottesville.
Right. So, Chip, I would like for you to discuss a little bit about the two organizations, the two organizations that merged to become the new organizations, Rights and Dissent, if you would, just to kind of give our listeners some background on what those organizations are about.
Sure. So over about a year ago, Defending Dissent Foundation and Bill of Rights Defense Committee merged together, and we used both names for about a year so people could ease into the transition, but we always intended to change our name to Defending Rights and Dissent. Defending Dissent Foundation traces itself back to 1960 when it was founded as a group to oppose the House Un-American Activities Committee. Bill of Rights Defense Committee was formed in 2001 as an Anti-Patriot Act group. Obviously, Defending Dissent Foundation, I keep wanting to call it by the new name for both
sure,
of them.
Sure,
I apologize. obviously, has done a lot more than just taking on UAC in the last 50 years, and Bill of Rights Defense Committee obviously had a much broader focus than just the Patriot Act, but both groups believed very much in grassroots movements to defend civil liberties, so it made perfect sense for us to merge together, and we had worked together for years organizing rallies and events and stuff like that, so it was a very natural merger, and we're a much stronger organization as a result of it.
Tell me a little bit about the activities that you involve yourself with. How do you make yourself known to various communities, and what are some of the activities that folks listening might like to be involved with?
So sure. So Defending Rights and Dissent does have local groups that we work with across the country. We have a very strong coalition in Montgomery County, Maryland, called the Montgomery County Civil Rights Coalition. We also have a good relationship in Oakland with the Oakland's Privacy Working Group. On a national level, we work a lot on issues around FBI surveillance. So a lot of groups do a lot of focus on like the high-tech electronic surveillance like the NSA does. And we're against that as well. But as a result, the FBI, sort of old school, like sending in an infiltrator to spy on your mosque or spy on your peace group, has unfortunately gone under the radar. And it's still going on. And it's under Trump administration, we're very, very afraid it will escalate. Another thing we work a lot on is we're very concerned with state and federal level bills that impact the right to protest. So you saw all of these bills across the country recently that tried to impose criminal penalties on organizers of protesters if people came and committed unlawful acts. You saw the really horrendous bills to remove civil and criminal liability for running over protesters. And then also in this sort of cacophony of anti-protest legislation, we like to include the anti-BDS bills, which are bills that are specifically targeting boycott, divestment, and sanctions campaigns for Palestinian human rights. And there's, of course, a federal bill right now that got quite a bit of attention that is also in that vein, targeting people who participate in boycotts of Israel that are initiated by intergovernmental organizations like the UN or the EU, and potentially sentencing them to 20 years in prison if they violate this bill's prohibition on it. My coworker, Sue Udy, works a lot on countering violent extremism, and that's a program that people are less familiar with. It is an FBI-run and a lot of times community-based-run program that is modeled after a UK program called Prevent, and it's sort of a minority report type thing. It's based on reaching people before they become violent extremists, but it's very heavily focused on the Muslim community, mm-hmm. and it really is just another way in which the U.S. government is spying on, surveilling, and criminalizing the Muslim community. It's oftentimes touted as like a soft approach to like law enforcement intervention, but that's just quite frankly not the case.
Chip, this is John. First of all, thank you for your good work in the area of civil liberties. I'm intrigued by what you had to say about the FBI, and I'm wondering if ConIntelPro is making a comeback, and whether you'd like to tell our audience a little something about that very dark chapter in federal law enforcement, and whether it's been rebranded for modern times.
So this is, I think, an interesting thing about COINTELPRO, is that the program is shut down in the early 70s. You have the church. COINTELPRO was, of course, the counterintelligence program. It was an effort to neutralize and disrupt what the FBI deemed to be subversive organizations. It was initially very focused on the Communist Party. It also included the Socialist Workers Party, which was a Trotskyist group who actually took the FBI to court and won. It's a pretty fascinating story. But most infamously, it was targeted against anti-Vietnam War protesters and Martin Luther King. The FBI tried to blackmail Dr. King into literally committing suicide. It's really horrendous and dark stuff. Our organization was spied on a little bit during that time period as well, because we were working against HUAC. And then you have the Church Committee, and the FBI is supposed to be reformed. But then the next major FBI scandal to get traction was the FBI spying on the committee in solidarity with the people of El Salvador, which in the late 70s, early 80s, people were very concerned about U.S. support for, you know, death squads and right-wing governments in El Salvador and throughout Central America. And the FBI just harassed and investigated these groups. And, you know, this started, and eventually the Senate has to have an investigation into it where they determine the FBI was, you know, not behaving itself, which is very unsurprising. But, I mean, the thing I like to stress is that Church Committee was in 1977, and this program begins in 1981, where they start spying on Central American Solidarity mm-hmm. activists. Mm-hmm. So there's clearly a long, continuous pattern, and it's worth pointing out how J. Edgar Hoover got his start with the FBI. Before it was the FBI, it was called the Bureau of Investigation, and he headed up the General Intelligence Division, which was also known as the Radical Division, and basically what that was a political police force that went out and, investigated people for their political beliefs. It's the one that carried out the Palmer raids.
Right.
The FBI from, its very inception after the McKinley assassination, when they're looking at anarchists, to, today has been a political police force. Right. So, COINTELPRO is a specific program. It gets the most attention, but I think it is wrong to view it as an isolated incident, and it isn't so much a question of is it coming back. It never went away right. from, my perspective.
Yeah, it's an FBI tradition.
J. Edgar Hoover literally got his start as head of the Radical Division. Right. There were red squads in police departments across the country. It was considered the norm to have groups that spied on people for their political views. This has been going on for a long time, and it's basically what the FBI does. And an interesting side note here is that after the Church Committee, there was a movement to impose a legislative charter on the FBI. And instead of doing that, they let the Attorney General write his own guidelines for the FBI and drop the charter thing. And you can imagine what happens when the Attorney General can rewrite the rules for the FBI anytime he wants. Non-civil libertarian Attorney Generals will weaken them. And they've been gradually been weakened over the years. The worst came in the last month of the Bush administration, during the lame duck administration, where the Attorney General McKasey allowed for an entirely new type of investigation to be made called an assessment. And with an assessment, the FBI does not need any sort of reason to believe you're involved in criminal activity or pose a threat to national security. They can just investigate you, assess you for fun. But, these assessments allow them to use very intrusive techniques such as confidential informants. So they really are
That's worth repeating, and I want you to repeat it. So you don't need reasonable suspicion or probable cause to initiate this investigation. Just repeat what you said.
It's called an assessment. It requires no suspicion whatsoever. It was created in the very last month of the Bush administration. It is a very shocking idea.
Yep.
It was a really strange, it was a really bad turn of events. We had always been going in this direction. We were lowering the level of suspicion, but this was just taking it away. And it's worth pointing out, Congress could do its job here. They could have imposed a statutory charter in the late 70s. This was not like a dream idea. Like Jimmy Carter was for this. Even some of the FBI directors are for this, but they just let themselves police.
Right.
And then in the late 80s, 1990s, our organization, in response to the Central American spying scandal, pushed for a bill called the FBI First Amendment Protection Act that would have required the FBI to have suspicion of criminal activity when investigating First Amendment protected activity. And that got part of that got in as an amendment to the Violent Crime Act of 1994, but less than 16 months later, Bill Clinton has it repealed. So Congress could step up to the gate here, but I would not hold your breath for that.
Two quick questions, and then I'm going to turn the microphone over to Mary for a while. We've had Colleen Rowley, FBI agent and attorney and Time Magazine Person of the Year on the show several times here at KMAC Radio, one of my heroes, as part of her settlement, continues to teach ethics, whistleblower ethics, at the FBI Academy in Quantico. So my question is this. Number one, What are the whistleblower protections within the FBI? Is Colleen Rowley just whistling in the dark down there in Quantico? And my second question is, how strong is the Inspector General's office at the Department of Justice and the FBI? We've heard Senator Feinstein here on this show lament to no end that the Central Intelligence Agency now has no IG. Obama did his best to kill that. There's virtually no oversight. I'm wondering whether the same is true for federal law enforcement. So, to the questions there, whistleblower sure. protections, and then also oversight by an inspector general.
So I'm not a specialist in whistleblower law, so I can't speak to what protections do or don't exist. If you talked to another expert on the subject and they told you they were bad, I would probably assume that was correct. And mm-hmm. We do know that whistleblowers are treated very horrendously in our society, and that if you expose war crimes in the United States, the only person to go to jail will be the person who exposes them. We saw that with Chelsea Manning. We mm-hmm. saw that with John Kiriakou. So I can't speak to the specific protections that exist, but I do know there's a general culture of waging war on whistleblowers that has been going on for, you know, since the Obama era. As far as the IG goes, the Department of Justice Inspector General in the mid-Bush era put out a very interesting report on the FBI's spying on political groups like PETA, Greenpeace, Catholic Worker. Mm-hmm. So there is somewhat of an Inspector General there, but they've not revisited that issue since then, and I'm fairly certain this report is 2006, 2009-ish. I don't know. I'm blanking on the date, mm-hmm. But, you know, the Inspector General for the DOJ has his hands full with all kinds of things. So, I mean, the FBI is always doing this. They should revisit the issue. I mean, what I would really like to see is for Congress to investigate. I mean, when it came out that the FBI was spying on Central American peace groups in the 1980s, the Senate actually had an investigation, not a hearing, a full investigation, and released a report. And I think they should be doing that to what we know about what groups the FBI has spied on. There's not a lot of political will within the Congress to do that.
Right.
So that's why I think grassroots organizing and mobilizing is important, because we need to create the political will for that. Because Congress has broad oversight powers. I mean, this is what they're supposed to be doing. There are a number of things they could do to rein in the FBI. They've just elected not to do so.
Right.
Shifting gears a bit, Chip, you had, and more importantly, this sort of relates to where we're going with your article from today. You had written back in 2014 about free speech and the conviction of a KKK member. I think his name was Clarence Brandenburg. And I think the name of the article is, "Does Crying Terrorism Trump Free Speech?" And as we know, President Trump was I don't even know if he still has called this domestic terrorism in Charlottesville. But could you talk about the Supreme Court case on political speech that you had written an article about just before we go into Charlottesburg?
Sure. So the article was actually about the Supreme Court refusing to hear the case of Tariq Mahana, who was a Muslim American man who was convicted of material support for terrorism. And, you know, his material support for terrorism was stuff like translating documents and, you know, expressing support for people in online forums. There was nothing that any reasonable person would recognize as anything beyond speech. So it was quite a controversial case. The ACLU, CCR, all these groups filed amicus briefs on his behalf, and his conviction was unfortunately overturned because, you know, the judge at the trial level would not give the jury a jury instruction that would have allowed them to assess whether his speech was protected by the First Amendment, and it raised a whole bunch of issues. The Brandenburg case is from the mid to late 1960s, and it's one of the most important cases in First Amendment law. There used to be these things called criminal anarchy or criminal syndicalist laws, clearly aimed at left-wing political views, anarchists and syndicalists. I don't know if people still know what syndicalists were, but they were like the industrial workers of the world, or these various left groups that thought like, you know, were sort of like socialist or communist or anarchist, like that general sort of, you know, world of like people who think the workers are going to take power. and a lot of states banned these points of view. Criminal anarchy and criminal syndicalism laws were used to prosecute members of the Socialist Party, members of the Communist Party, and they're upheld pretty continuously until the 1960s when a man named Brandenburg, who is a member of the Ku Klux Klan, is indicted under them. And this goes all the way to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court finally does what it should have done 30 years ago and says, you know, these laws are unconstitutional, mm-hmm. and they articulate a test for when speech can be prohibited, and they decide that sort of like abstract advocacy of violence is protected by the First Amendment. So if I say, you know, I'm an anarchist, I think the anarchist should rise up and take power, you know, that is speech. That is not a criminal act. What they did say is that when you incite imminent lawless action and you have the specific intent to do so, that's not protected. That's a very high threshold. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a good thing that that threshold is so high, because like I said, even though this case was about a Ku Klux Klan member, and I imagine, you know, most of your listeners find white supremacy abhorrent because it is abhorrent, mm-hmm. and he was an abhorrent person, but, you know, it struck down these laws that were crafted and used to repress the left. So I think it's a good reminder that when we start talking about tampering with restrictions of political speech, that the courts aren't going to read those as an exception to the free speech rights of people we don't like. They're going to use that as an exception to free speech more generally. And you will see people who say, you know, Black Lives Matter. I think this is a stupid statement, you know, but Black Lives Matter is hate speech, or if the right to boycott to work I do when I testify before state legislators, with people trying to take the rights away from people who want to engage in Palestinian human rights advocacy, they'll say that's hate speech as well. So I understand that a lot of people are looking at the rise of white supremacists and Nazi groups right now, and it's really very, very frightening. I don't think any of us thought we'd be living the year of 2017 and see, you know, white supremacists with torches yelling slogans from Nazi Germany like blood and soil in this day and age. But when you start tampering with the framework of free speech, you have to ask yourself, am I ultimately fashioning the weapon that's going to be used against me?
Exactly. And this brings me to Charlottesville and what happened there a couple weekends ago. President Trump came out and said that both sides were at fault. And I wondered if you would give your take on that statement, and also the fact that the FBI has allowed, let's say, neo-Nazis, white nationalists in these protests with, I have to tell you, when I saw those torches and the people marching, they just were missing their sheets. It just was astonishing. And so I wondered if you could react to the some of the comments that have come out of this, and what your, from your perspective.
I mean, I remember when I first saw those pictures of torches, it was a Friday night, and I had been back with I'd been out with some friends, you know, it was Friday in D.C., and somebody commented, like, things are getting really bad in Charlottesville, and I looked at Twitter, because that's where we all get our breaking news now, and I saw that photo of those, you know, four mm-hmm. or five UVA students just surrounded by that mob of bigots with fire, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. with torches, and I was so shocked. I mean, I know, you know, we have a history of white supremacy in this country. You know, we were founded with the genocide of the Native Americans, with chattel slavery. But, you know, even taking that into account, I don't think I was expecting to see people like that marching with torches. And then the next day, I didn't go to Charlottesville, but I have a lot of friends who did. Mm-hmm. So I was paying sort of close attention. And then that car attack happened, and it just really, I don't know, it really struck a raw nerve. You just can't ever prepare yourself for something like that. And thankfully,
a car was weaponized.
I said
a car was weaponized in this instance.
Yes.
Can you speak to free speech and the Second Amendment as briefly as much as you'd like, in terms of when is it okay to have arms at a free speech rally?
I'm not an expert on Second Amendment issues. We don't have strong takes on the Second Amendment at Defending Rights and Dissent. you know, Virginia is an open carry state.
Mm-hmm.
I personally find that, and I'm speaking as myself and not as defending rights and dissent.
No, I understood.
I think I react to open carry the way most people do. Why are there people marching with assault weapons down the street? That seems like kind of a problem. But what's really interesting to me is that the ACLU, who had originally defended the white supremacist, came out with a position that they would not defend white supremacists if they marched with arms again in the future.
Right.
And a lot of people were touting that as a new position, but the Los Angeles Times did a whole review of sort of the ACLU's defense of Nazis, and obviously they were involved in the Skokie case, which is quite famous, but they picked out their first ever public statement on why they defended Nazis, and it was in 1934. And they go on and on about how they defend their right to march, and then they get to the end, they go, the one thing we won't defend, though, is their right to carry guns. We are against these groups having guns, and we would even potentially support legislation to disarm them.
Hmm.
So I think that the issue of Nazis with guns has always been one that is difficult for people who are very firm free speech absolutists, who understand the fact that any attack on free speech rights is eventually going to be used against not white supremacists, but movements for racial justice, movements for peace, because those are the movements the state always comes after. But, you know.
Yeah, it's...
I don't know why you need to take an assault weapon.
Yeah, an AR-15. Yeah.
And that's not a DRAD, because that's not a defending rights and dissent position. That is just my own personal reaction.
Well, my question is, what would you use an AR-15 for? Why would you have a license in the country? What is that used for? It's not a hunting rifle. What is it used for, and why would you be permitted in the United States?
We don't have a position on gun control one way or the other, and I don't work on Second Amendment law.
Right.
That's an area I'm entirely unfamiliar with, but I think your reaction is one that a lot of people have with these sorts of weapons.
The point being, the other side had cardboard signs and flags. You know, I mean, it's just a real unbalance there. If you've just joined us, it's 27 minutes past the hour. I'm speaking with Chip Gibbons, who is a writer whose work has focused on civil liberties, U.S. foreign policy, social movements, and the Middle East. His work has been published in the past by Truth Out, Dissent News Wire, and Counterpunch, among other publications. He attended Bard College, where he majored in history and political studies. He later received a Juris Doctorate at American University Washington College of Law, where he was also co-director of the National Lawyers Guild chapter. He completed an undergraduate thesis on the Central American Peace and Solidarity Movement. He has studied both as an undergraduate and as a law student the effects of anti-terrorism legislation on the First Amendment rights of solidarity activists. I'd like to look at your article that was published today, The Defending Rights and Dissent. If you could, why did you write the article, and tell our listeners what it's about and where they can find it?
Sure. So right after Heather, the woman who was murdered by the white supremacist, mm-hmm. with a car, a number of people pointed out that there were a bunch of bills across the country that would have basically removed liability from running a protester over. All of those bills specify that it has to be an unintentional act, so it seems very unlikely that they would have, you know, provided any modicum of protection to the man who murdered her, his car. But, you know, nonetheless, people were drawing that parallel. And I had worked on this issue previously. I mean, these types of bills are one of the things we work on, and it's kind of a few-year-old biography you're reading of me. More recently, I've written for Jacobin and The Nation, and I wrote an entire article from both Jacobin and the National Lawyers Guild publication exploring these state-by-state bills, including the car ones. So I wanted to talk more about, you know, about this. And, you know, North Carolina has one of these bills in session. They said they're not going anywhere with it. But the person who sponsored it came out and said, oh, it's intellectually dishonest to compare, you know, what my bill would have allowed and what this guy was doing, because you know, it's unintentional. He's clearly intentional.
Right.
But, you know, that's sort of a nonsense statement. I mean, you know, there's no crisis in this country of people unintentionally running over protesters and then having going to jail. I mean, you know, the best thing you could say about these bills is that they're a response to a non-existent problem. And the worst thing you can say about them is they're sort of a wink, wink, nudge, nudge to people who want to commit these types of acts. I mean, and when you literally only single out people who strike protesters with cars and nobody else who unintentionally hits anyone else with a car, you're sending quite an inflammatory message about how you value dissent. And there's a whole culture around this. There's a Tumblr page called runthemover.tumblr, and it just collects people's threats to run over Black Lives Matter protesters. There's all these really disgusting bumper stickers and memes on the internet that say things like all lives splatter with people running over protesters you can put on your cars. So, I mean, there's this whole culture out there of people who are, you know, boasting about how they would like to run over protesters. There's an enormously large number of police officers who have gotten in trouble for posting these sentiments on social media, including, I believe, it was a Cambridge officer who posted positive things about running over that poor woman in Charlottesville on his Facebook account. And you know, if you really want to go back in time, George Wallace during the 1968 presidential campaign was bragging about how protesters got in front of his limousine and he'd have them run over. It's a very Trumpian statement. So, I mean, I wrote this article because I feel like whether or not these bills would have decriminalized the act that took place last Sunday, and I don't think they would have. I actually agree with the sponsors of them there. They're clearly part of promoting a culture where, you know, you devalue the lives of dissenters. And it's worth pointing out that these bills are very, very, very implicitly racist in that the first one that was proposed was in relationship to Standing Rock protesters. And when you see things like All Lives Splatter, which is very clearly a disgusting take on All Lives Matter, it's clearly that these movements of marginalized people, people of color, who are standing up and saying, we're human too, we have dignity, and the people's response is, we don't care about their protests, let's run them over and murder them. I mean, which just illustrates why these movements exist in the first place.
Chip, this is
it's
John.
It's very dark. It was a very difficult thing to write. I started a week ago, but I just went down such a dark hole of this subculture of right-wing internet memes about murdering people with cars that it was, you know, just difficult to even write.
This is John again. I just wanted to make one comment and then ask a question. And the comment is, we were talking about FBI traditions, dubious FBI traditions, like with the COINTELPRO. We also have this tradition of running over protesters as well. In 1968, as you point out in your article, George Wallace made the statement that, quote, segregation today, segregation tomorrow, segregation forever, and boasted that if any demonstrator lays down in front of my car, it'll be the last car he ever lays down in front of. So running over protesters seems to be a Southern tradition that goes back to George Wallace in 1968. My question is, how can you conflate the ways the Black Lives Matter and the protest in Charlotte, the anti-protest in Charlottesville, conflate with say the protest in Standing Rock, insofar as racism and dehumanization seems to be a major theme?
I don't understand the conflate them with what exactly?
How this carries over? So you have the dehumanization and the racist behavior directed at Black Lives Matter, but now we see a kind of like jumping over the racial line from Black protesters to, you know, the protesters that were at Standing
Rock. Protesters in general.
Yeah, protesters in general.
Yeah.
And at Standing Rock, you know, they were environmentalists. Most of them were white. Most of them were non-native. Most of them were educated. And you just see the same kind of attitude of racism and dehumanization.
I mean, I would push back on Standing Rock. It was an indigenous-led movement, and I think the really dark racism that came out was the result of that. There is definitely a history of racism towards indigenous people, and I think that definitely impacted the lens through which we viewed Standing Rock, whether or not they were white environmentalists acting in solidarity or not.
Okay.
I mean, I think, and I talked about this in both the article I wrote for Jacobin and the National Lawyers Guild on this topic is that, you know, repression of dissent is the norm. So it's not surprising that there are people who want to shut down protests more generally, who want to run over protesters. But when you have, you know, certain movements attract more vitriol and more repression in general. So it's not necessarily surprising that, like, your local peace group is infiltrated by the FBI, but, like, look at them, like, sending, like, militarized police out to respond in Ferguson. So the sort of racism and the antipathy for dissent sort of be mixed together and create a very sort of ugly resolve. So I wouldn't say so much it's jumping from the one to the other. I think the underlying trend there is hatred, protest, hatred for democracy. And, you know, with our own histories of racism, it is sort of exacerbated and worsened when movements by marginalized people, by people of color, try to act for, you know, their basic human rights.
So I'm getting
that is how I would analyze the situation.
Okay, I'm getting a question here from a listener who maintains that what we're really talking about here is a police state that's indiscriminate in its repression of dissent, because they're taking the devil's advocate position here, that the FBI and federal law enforcement was not only dismissive of Black Lives Matter and Standing Rock, but also, say, if you go to the Freemen over at Ruby Ridge, or more recently
Ridge, Waco,
right,
yeah.
or Waco, or more recently the protesters with Lavoie Finicum in Oregon. You know, the federal law enforcement is out to squash you like a grape, no matter who you are.
I mean, that's definitely true, but they go after some movements more than they go after others. I mean, a number of people have commented on, you know, look at the way they responded in Ferguson with militarized police, mm-hmm. with tanks, with stuff that looks like an occupying or invading army versus, you know, in Charlottesville, where you actually had armed men in military-style gear marching down the street. So there is a double standard. I don't deny that there are instances like Ruby Ridge and Waco where the FBI had gone in and repressed right-wing actors, but I also think there are latent biases within the FBI, both racial and political, that means they usually gravitate towards some movements more than others, and okay. Their oppression for those movements are harsher than others, which is not to deny what happened at Ruby Ridge or deny what happened at Waco. I'm very familiar with those incidents, but, I mean, just look at how they respond to Ferguson versus how they respond mm-hmm. to Charlottesville. Right. Look at how much time they spend infiltrating, you know, people who want to close down the School of the Americas versus, you know, militias, which is not saying they should do more of the other or they're not doing the other. It's just, you know, pointing out that there is a double standard here.
Okay.
And I think it's fine to say, you know, there's a generalized sort of repressive atmosphere, and I think that's true. But I think if you don't acknowledge the other sort of instances of power and structural bias and double standards here, you're doing a disservice.
Chip, back to the FBI. Do you have a sense as to whether or not the FBI or the NSA is monitoring these kind of hate websites, if you will, All Lives Splatter and so forth? And if so, what do you suppose they're doing with that information as we go forward?
I mean, the FBI, like the listener brought up, has done stuff at Ruby Ridge and Waco. I would be a little bit surprised, and they have, you know, heavily infiltrated neo-Nazi and white supremacist movements in the past. There was a movie with Daniel Radcliffe recently about an FBI agent who infiltrates a neo-Nazi group, and it's loosely based off of Mike German. I don't know if you know who he is, but he used to work at the ACLU. He's now at the Brennan Center, and before that, he was an FBI agent who infiltrated neo-Nazi groups, and now does a lot of good civil liberties work. So there is a history of that. I would be rather surprised if they weren't doing that. I do know there was the Intercept FBI leaks, where there was the one where they the FBI was sort of aware that these groups were, these right-wing white supremacist groups were infiltrating police departments, mm-hmm. which is disturbing, and that nobody really wanted to talk about that issue. So I don't want to. I would be really shocked if the FBI was not at all monitoring the situation. What they're doing with that information, I don't know. It's a very interesting question.
Let's talk about that issue for a second. We're broadcasting here from Mendocino County, which is 3 hours north of San Francisco. We're very rural. We're only 88,000 residents spread out over 2,400 square miles. Marijuana is the bedrock of the economy, and everybody's armed, even hippies. They call them redneck hippies. Everybody's got a weapon here. Everybody's got a concealed weapons permit, or if they don't have the permit, they have the gun anyway. And here in this county, and not that long ago, because I was actually the plaintiff in this lawsuit, we had a district attorney, Norm Roman, who was literally arming a militia with fully automatic Heckler Koch 5, MP5, assault weapons with silencers. Those are two ATF violations, by the way, fully automatic and with silencers. And a district attorney is not a law enforcement officer, as you know. He's an officer. He or she is an officer of the court. Right before a federal task force executed a search warrant, he dropped dead of a heart attack, which was unfortunate because I would have liked to have seen this case investigated and prosecuted. So we have a precedent right here in our county where you have an effort to arm a militia. Do you want to say something about the infiltration of law enforcement by the alt-right, if you will?
I mean, this is once again outside of my area of specialty. I focus on law enforcement infiltration of political groups. I know there are people who study the other side, and it's not something I have enough knowledge on that I could fully comment on. But I would point out there was an incident in Portland recently where a militia member helped a Portland police officer arrest a counter-protester, mm-hmm. which was a really disturbing image. So, I mean, this is a problem. I don't know enough to comment on it, but
well,
it's ground from a First Amendment perspective, but I just...
But you know enough to say with some authority that it's a phenomenon. It does exist.
There was the Intercept article that was based off of documents from the FBI. I saw that. I believe this is something that is going on, yes.
Okay, thank
you. To what extent, how much of a threat it is, I really, really don't know, and I'm not comfortable giving you an assessment of it.
Okay. Understood. Well, you know, our previous guest from last week, Arun Gupta, was speaking about this very thing as to police officers are members of these hate groups, these white supremacy hate groups, and you know, he said in fact that those exist. And so my question to him, and I guess again to you, is what is the FBI doing? If that's the case, and we think it is, and he says we know it is, what is the FBI, what do they need to do to prevent this kind of terrorism? And do you see Charlottesville, would you describe it as a domestic terrorist event?
Well, first I want to say that Arun is on the Defending Rights and Dissent Board of Directors, and he's a very smart guy. And when I was referencing the story about the Portland police officer,
right.
I was relying on his reporting. So if you had him on this subject, I would say you had the expert on. I mean, I don't know what the FBI is doing. I mean, that's even with the work that I do know about, the problem is that, you know, we find out what the FBI does 5 years later after they do it.
Right.
My personal take on Charlottesville, and this is not a Defending Rights and Dissent opinion, this is my own, is that I don't know how you could not label it a terrorist attack when someone in ISIS runs over someone with a car in France or somewhere else in Europe. We have no problems calling it a terrorist attack.
Mm-hmm.
This is a neo-Nazi white supremacist plowing through a group of people for their political beliefs to murder them. I mean, if that's not terrorism, then you're going to have to say a lot of what ISIS does isn't terrorism. I mean, you can't have it both ways.
Right, right. Well, you know, as I said at the head of the show, President Trump has been reluctant to call this a domestic terrorist act. And, you know, the other thing that Arun had mentioned is that the Department of Homeland Security, where are they when many of us feel this was a domestic terrorist act? And, you know, that's why I was asking the question. What is your organization, does your organization involve itself with going forward on these kinds of things? Do you try to educate the public about what is and isn't freedom of speech, and then when does it become a terrorist act?
So that's not something that we do. We're very much on the civil liberty side of things, and I'm not saying the other part isn't valuable, but this, you know, our perspective is that we're a civil liberties group. We're not a law enforcement group. We're not a national security advisory group. We can tell you what policies are constitutional or not, but we're not experts on law enforcement, so I can't tell, you know, law enforcement what the best policy to pursue is.
Well, just,
I can tell them whether or not they violate the Fourth Amendment, but I you know, they should talk to someone who has more expertise in this area. I will point one thing out on the DHS comment. When Dylan Roof, the person who shot up the church in Charleston, the FBI would not call it terrorism. 2 weeks later, or very shortly after, they arrested two animal rights activists who had freed mink from a fur farm on federal terrorism charges. Because there is a law called the Animal Enterprises Terrorism Act, and if you free mink, you're guilty of animal enterprise terrorism. So,
wow.
You know, regardless of what you think of spray painting a barn with liberation is love and freeing captive animals, it's really perverse for the FBI to be touting this as a big terrorist crackdown just 2 weeks after they said a white supremacist neo-Nazi who had a Rhodesian flag, you know, on its personal website, flag of the white supremacist Rhodesian apartheid state, you know, just murdered a bunch of people because of the color of their skin in hopes to start a race war, isn't. So, I mean, there is some problems here. There's a lot of problems. I think
exactly.
That's the understatement of the hour.
So I wanted to ask you, we have about, I don't know, 4 or 5 more minutes with you. And I wanted you to speak again about what your organization does, and specifically how listeners can get involved, let's say, at the the activities at a grassroots level in the various, and is this something that's in every city or just selected cities? And give yourselves a little plug in how folks might be able to get in touch or become involved.
So we're really big believers in grassroots actions. The Bill of Rights Defense Committee got started when people would pass Anti-Patriot Act resolutions in their local municipalities. And we have an entire toolkit of legislation on our website that you could pass at your city council level or your town council level that would have a meaningful impact in fighting.
And could you give that website, please?
Yeah, it is www.rightsanddissent.org.
Right.
And there's an entire model toolkit of legislation. One of the things I encourage people the most to look into is that the Federal Bureau of Investigation has these Joint Terrorism Task Force, and they're run by the FBI, but they're staffed in large part by local police officers.
Hmm.
And the local police officers act under the authority of the FBI. And, you know, we hear about the Joint Terrorism Task Force officers going around and visiting Standing Rock protesters and harassing them, and that could be an FBI agent, that could be your local police officer. So cooperation with the JTTFs are entirely voluntary, and there are two ways you could take action against them. One would be to get your city to cut off cooperation completely, and I think that's the best case scenario. I don't think the FBI needs to be using your police officers who you're paying for to do their work.
Hmm.
But the other thing that most people don't realize is that when these local law enforcement agrees to participate, they sign a memorandum of understanding with the FBI that means they'll follow the Attorney General guidelines as opposed to local and state law in their investigations. And that was those guidelines I was talking about at the beginning of the program and how loose they are. And in most jurisdictions, you know, the police regulations are a lot more stringent. And there was a city in the California Bay Area, I'm blanking on which one, who passed a law saying that the police, when they were acting with the FBI, had to follow California law, had to follow California civil rights protection and California civil liberties protections. And I would say passing bills like that are a really good idea. Mm-hmm. I know a lot of people are interested in the idea of sanctuary cities where you cut off cooperation with ICE. But, you know, just because you've ended cooperation with ICE, if you're still interacting with the JTTF, ICE is part of the JTTF, so you haven't fully cut off cooperation with them. So I would encourage people to go the next step and start looking into their local law enforcement's ties with FBI, Joint Terrorism Task Force, and either, you know, push the city council to cut off ties completely or mandate that the police follow local and state civil rights and privacy laws when acting under the authority of the FBI,
so
which
you,
is a very reasonable demand. I mean, the police should not be violating California law or violating Maryland law when, you know,
mm-hmm.
just because the FBI has these ridiculous attorney general's guidelines that are very, very weak. And I most likely, whatever your jurisdiction is, has more stringent guidelines than the AG. I mean, it's not guaranteed per se, but the FBI ones have just been so weakened and so watered down.
Right. And you also
like
have
75% chance that this is.
Excuse me for talking over
on.
You. You also have a personal website, I believe, is a blog. Are you still writing on that? And what is that about?
My personal website is www.chipgibbons.org. I used to have a Blogspot website years ago. I don't update it with regular blog posts, mm-hmm. but I do try to compile all of my writings. So I write a lot for Jacobin magazine. I recently wrote an article about Christopher Wray for The Nation. So I
right.
try to use
that,
to compile all of my writings.
Yeah.
I used to run a regular blog between writing for, you know, Jacobin, Truth Out, The Nation, and working a full-time job. I haven't done as much blogging.
Yeah.
But it's not because I'm not writing. It's because people are actually publishing my writing.
You have some terrific articles on that website. I visited yesterday, and it has a wide variety of many good things to read about. Chip Gibbons, we would like to thank you for being our guest today. It's been a pleasure, and we hope you'll come back. I want to mention again what Chip is involved. He is a writer whose work has focused on civil liberties, primarily U.S. foreign policy, social movements, and the Middle East. His work has been published in the past by Jacobin, Truth Out, Dissent Newswire, and Counterpunch, among other publications. He has maintained the blog, which we talked about, Exiting Emerald. Mr. Gibbons attended Bard College, where he majored in history and political studies. He later received his JD at American University. And he has studied both as an undergraduate and a law student about anti-terrorism legislation. Chip, thank you so much for being our guest today.
Thank you for having me.
All righty.
Wonderful interview.
And a happy, happy eclipse.
Thank you very much. Have a good day.
Bye now.
So, today is the eclipse, and I am delighted to, I've read a terrific poem, but I want to mention a little bit about the eclipse in general, and then John has something that he'd like to share with all of us. So the entire event today will take about an hour and a half to happen. I think it's already happened in California. And so for eclipse chasers, it's a party of a lifetime, a phenomenon like this in which the eclipse travels across the entire continental United States hasn't happened in 99 years. It was June 8th, 1918, and the World War I would officially end in a few months. So having said that, John, who is back in the studio today, is also a poet, and a good poet. And I asked him if he would maybe read his poem that he shared with me today called Solar Eclipse. Would you like to say something about it first, John? Or
Thank you, Mary. Yeah, I've come back to poetry later in life. I've won a Penn Award earlier in my life and was a protege of Mark Strand. As I transition to the next stage of my life, this is mainly what I want to be doing, that and being a good dad and a good grandfather and a good steward of the land on my ranch. So I call this poem, and I plan on reading it at the Esalen Institute in October. I call this poem Solar Eclipse. Solar Eclipse. Like a blown bulb's filament, The sun sizzled and sputtered before it burned through its weakest point with an audible pop. Or did it? As the sun approached syzygy with the earth and moon, everything went quiet and the wind died down. The shutters over the eyes of my horses closed shut, and His Majesty of Daylilies knelt on bended knee behind my barn to the scorching half-light of the eclipse's midpoint, the subsolar point. True, the night that followed was artificial. True, nothing could live in that night. But I could dwell forever in a paradise of silence, the sounds of lies and secrets breathing their last. Nothing is more real.
Thank you, John. That's our show today. I would like to give our underwriters some recognition here. So, Heroes and Patriots, a show about national security, intelligence, and foreign policy, is sponsored by Dr. Richard Phillips at the Ukiah Dental Center, located at 307 Luce Avenue. Visit his website at ukiahdental.com. Dunlap Roofing, roofing and gutter service with offices in Fort Bragg, Ukiah, and Willits. Visit their website at dunlaproofing.com. Fry Vineyards and Winery in Redwood Valley, America's first organic winery. Great local wines with no added sulfites, produced biodynamically on the web at frywine.com. And Or Hot Springs, a retreat and natural hot springs. Reservations are required. Please call 707-462-6277 or visit their website to make your reservation at orhotsprings.org. Heroes and Patriots is hosted by John Goodiron and Mary Massey. We invite listeners to hear our podcasts at both Facebook and YouTube. That's Heroes and Patriots, KMEC Radio, the Mendocino Environmental Center. Thank you.
And today is August 21st, 2017. We neglected to mention the date of the show for those of you who are bookmarking the show.
Right. And a special thanks to Patrick Swift and Elliot Hershkovitz-Hale, who have been our summer interns and have done a great job. We also like to thank Govinda Dalton and Sid Cooperreiter, who provide ongoing technical support for the show. Our thanks to all. We will be back next week, so we hope you'll tune in again. Again, this is Mary Massey and John Goodire saying thanks to all.